Welcome to Annette on America, hosted by Annette Bybee, God-fearing, freedom-loving mother, college professor, lawyer, talking to you about all things freedom, all things America.
On America. This is Annette Bybee, recovering lawyer, single mom to two teens and a tween, and hanging in there through this lovely winter. I'm not a fan. Those of you that live here in Colorado are thinking, why do you live in Colorado if you're not a fan of winter? What can I say? Came here for family. Stay here because we now live here. Anyway, speaking of Colorado, let me get some Colorado news out here first for my Denver listeners. So I don't know how many of you know this, but we have a whole tsunami of higher taxes and fees and paycheck cuts coming here in Colorado. Isn't that great? If one phrase defines the 2023 outlook in Colorado, it's sticker shock. What's happening? New surcharges on top of elevated inflation, rising property assessments, and skyrocketing energy bills are creating an avalanche of new costs for consumers. Tell me about it. My Xcel electricity and gas bill, it's about 150% of what it usually is. And I can guarantee you that a big part of that is because they're building infrastructure for the electric cars that are going to be foisted on us by King Polis, who does everything California does. So that's not going to go down anytime soon. And speaking of which, gas, have you pumped up your, filled your tank lately? It's back over $4 a gallon again. So we can't catch a break, especially here in Colorado. What else do we have going on? Let's see. Our cost of living, of course, is higher than the national average. And of course, the new taxes and fees are going to make it worse. And guess what? This, of course, comes from the Democrats. Many of the additional expenses are driven by a handful of prior Democratic-aligned laws just now taking effect, including two mandated paycheck cuts. Workers that aren't self-employed, which is probably the majority of us, will see a portion of their salaries go to cover the state's new paid family leave program, which voters approved in 2020. This voter right here did not approve this. Just saying. The benefits, of course, won't come until 2024, but we get to start paying taxes on it this year. And companies that don't offer retirement savings must deduct 5% from employee pay and put it in an IRA unless workers opt out. So we're going to force you into this, people. Meanwhile, a 2 cent per gallon tax gas fee takes effect this year after a 6-month delay. It comes just as the shutdown of the Suncor oil refinery may increase local gas prices. They already are. Motor vehicle registration will go up $29 to cover a state park pass unless owners opt out. So if you live in Colorado, make sure that when you get your registration form that you make sure that you opt out of that $29 fee. Notice that they don't make it an option that you can opt into. Oh, no, no. They're hoping that a bunch of us will just be morons and just, my registration went up $29. What a bummer. Instead of looking at it and opting out. So opt out, people. Opt out. A 10-cent consumer fee on plastic and paper bags at retailers signed by the governor in 2021 started this month. Now, that's something else I want to know about. Why are we paying it on paper bags? I thought plastic was the culprit. Doesn't make a lot of sense, does it? The only thing I can figure is that they didn't want to give places like Trader Joe's a leg up over the plastic bag people. Again, nobody asked me about that. All right, and high income earners will see tax cuts in their standard deductions to pay for voter approved school meals program. Again, didn't vote for that one. The big picture. Inflation is expected to increase 4.9% in Metro Denver in 2023, and property taxes are increasing an average 27% statewide. Xcel Energy customers also are seeing spikes in monthly electricity and natural gas bills from rate hikes and cold weather. God, we get these emails. I'm sure you all in the same boat with me if you live in Colorado. Emails from Excel trying to explain what's going on and giving you some false hope that, oh, your bill will be coming down. Don't worry. Uh-huh. In addition, many municipalities raised taxes in the 2022 election. Denver residents are getting new bills for trash service, fees for sidewalk maintenance, and higher taxes to fund libraries. The general theme is it's becoming more expensive to live here in Colorado, and if we don't watch out, we'll start to become less competitive to other states relative to attracting and keeping business, economist Stephen Byers at the Conservative Common Sense Institute says. Yes, but a voter-approved income tax will soften the blow, particularly for high earners, and the state is issuing taxpayer refunds because of its surplus revenue. Well, I'm waiting on that, pretty sure. Well, I'm not a high earner, so. Anyway, minimum wage increase also took effect this month. That's not a good thing either. All right, so bad news for Coloradans. Just thought I would share that, spread that news. So if you're wondering why everything seems expensive all of a sudden, it's for those reasons. We've got higher taxes, higher utility costs, on top of inflation. Thank you, Democrats. And now we have a supermajority in our state legislature, so not good. I'm working on getting a state senator or state rep to come onto my show and talk about some of the other bills that are coming down the pike, because it's not good. Not when you have a supermajority of Democrats. All right, what else we got? We have so many things going on this week. More talk about national divorce. And I actually did a whole episode on an Article 5 convention, which is what I see as an answer to the fact that we have red states and blue states that cannot agree, right? But we have Marjorie Taylor Greene talking about how we need a national divorce. And, you know, it's hard to imagine what that looks like, right? Are you going to have a bunch of seceding people seceding from the state, from the country, and joining together? It's not like all the blue states are together or all the red states are together. So I don't see that as being a tenable solution. But I would like to say that I think an Article 5 Convention of States where we amend the Constitution is something that would, like I said, and I've done a couple of episodes where I spent some considerable time on this, but basically what it does is it puts back in place the way we're supposed to run in the first place, which is to be a federalist country, which does not mean the federal government has the power. It means the power is pushed back to the states where it belongs. And then if you're in a red state, your state can govern in a red way. If you're in a blue state, your state can govern in a blue way. The problem is that so much power has gone up to the federal government that we're not being governed in that way. And so it doesn't matter where you live when it comes to some issues. Now, COVID was a pretty good example of actually how federalism is supposed to work. States handled COVID the way they wanted to handle COVID. Where we saw problems was when the federal government tried to mess with that, like with OSHA trying to put in vaccine mandates, or putting vaccine mandates on our military or our federal employees. See, that's the kind of thing that shouldn't be happening. I mean, obviously the federal government's in charge of the military, but that was a giant overreach. So anyway, I think the national divorce talk is going to keep going for a while, but unless some states secede, I don't see that this divorce happening in any way that can work. Like I said, I see an Article 5 Convention of States. Go look it up if you don't know what that is. But basically, it's where we amend the Constitution and we put in several amendments that push the power back to the states, like I said. So, oh, and this just happened. So we've been seeing this big spill in Ohio, in East Palestine. I guess it's Palestine. I was saying Palestine, but Buttigieg not doing anything about it. And the residents there being told, oh, it's all good. The water's good. The air's good. Come on back. No problem. Come on back. And I think that probably would have been the MO. And we would have just seen nothing happen, except that enough journalists mostly conservative talk shows like mine have been putting up a stink and saying, you can't just leave these people there hung out to dry with water they can't drink and air they can't breathe. And so obviously worthless land. You just can't do that. This wreck happened on, I think, the 3rd. And here we are. I'm recording on the 21st. It's been weeks now. And no real action taken by the federal government. So Buttigieg, though, he's been really on the shtick, making sure that we know that there aren't enough Black construction workers. That's really important. Nothing is more important than diversity, equity, and inclusion. Doesn't matter if you spill a bunch of contaminants all over the place, right? It's pretty. There are a lot of great memes going around on Facebook right now about this, how the EPA is saying this is totally safe. No problem. Anyway, so this just came in today. The U.S. Environmental Protection Agency on Tuesday announced that it would be seizing oversight of the ongoing Ohio train derailment disaster, ordering the company behind the incident to submit to an EPA-approved cleanup as part of its management of the crisis. Oh, okay, I remember the rest of the meme. So at the top of the meme, they have this controlled burn that was basically an explosion in Ohio. And it said, EPA says it's safe or whatever. And then at the bottom, they show some gas-powered stoves. And it's dangerous. EPA says dangerous. It's the kind of thing where it's funny because it's true and it's so absurd. It's hard to believe it. But yes, we've been told that gas stoves are totally dangerous. But this major spill of these toxic chemicals, not a problem. Anyway, the EPA said in a press release that it would approve a work plan outlining all steps necessary to clean up the environmental damage caused by the derailment. If the company Norfolk Southern fails to complete any actions as ordered by the EPA, the agency will immediately step in, conduct the necessary work, and then seek to compel Norfolk Southern to pay triple the cost, the announcement continued. The derailment in question occurred on February 3rd near East Palestine, Ohio, when a nearly 2-mile-long train jumped the tracks there, scattering dozens upon dozens of cars across the crash site. Officials in the area subsequently performed a controlled burn at the site, one that spread chemicals such as hydrogen chloride and phosgene, whatever that is, into the local environment. EPA Administrator Michael Regan said on Tuesday that the crash, quote, has upended the lives of East Palestine families, unquote, and that the agency's order, quote, will ensure the company is held accountable for jeopardizing the health and safety of this community, unquote. As we transition from the emergency response, EPA will continue to coordinate closely with our local, state, and federal partners through a whole-of-government approach to support the East Palestine community during the remediation phase, Regan continued, adding, to the people of East Palestine, EPA stands with you now and for as long as it may take. Well, I say it's about time. This is something that should have happened a few weeks ago. What I would want to add to that is we know the only reason that they finally stepped in to do the right thing is because this has been on the news and on the news and on the news and on the news. And it's so outrageous that someone finally probably said, oh, this is a bad look for this administration. And Buttigieg is going to run for president. We can't leave him hanging out to dry. Let's do something. So what has to happen now is that we've got to continue to cover this and cover it and cover it until we know that every last homeowner, business owner, landowner, anyone that lives anywhere near the crash site that might possibly be affected by that train derailment is made whole. That's what's got to happen. So I am going to be following up on that and following up on that and following up on that, because otherwise, you know, this is just going to fade away and these people are going to be left with nothing. So we've got to keep the pressure on the EPA to make sure that this actually is done. It does kind of make you wonder why this took so long. Who is the train, Norfolk Southern, who is that business in bed with that they were able to just sort of not do much about this? Is there some kind of a private-public partnership with the government? Something not right there. All right. Oh, and here was something that was really interesting that happened recently with Project Veritas and James O'Keefe. James O'Keefe put out a 44-minute video. I think I watched it yesterday. And he basically said that he has been kicked out as CEO and board member from Project Veritas. And I that was confusing to me because I thought James O'Keefe basically was Project Veritas. And if you want to watch the video, go find it. But in it, he says that he doesn't know why this is happening. He said there were some complaints that he made it kind of sound like this was something that the board was out to get him for. And a few times he said he doesn't, that the timing on it is suspicious because they had just put out their most watched videos to date on the Pfizer, with the Pfizer executive that admitted that Pfizer was working to come up with different mutations of COVID so they could sell more vaccines. And so I guess that, I think that video had something like 50 million views. I mean, huge. This is the biggest thing Project Veritas has ever done. And so James O'Keefe is saying, hey, I don't understand why this is happening right when this happened. The implication there is that there was some kind of pressure maybe on the board by Pfizer. So I don't know. I also read that there were several complaints by employees about James O'Keefe and that there were complaints that he was misusing donations because that's how they operate. They get donations. So I don't know if we're ever going to know the whole story behind that. Pressure by Pfizer wouldn't surprise me, but who knows? Maybe there was a toxic work environment there. I don't know. It just seems strange to me that the guy that started this whole thing is now out on his ear. I guess that's why you don't have a board. I mean, they can kick you out of your own company. Anyway, and what he said towards the end of that video was that he was going to go and start another company and probably, he didn't go into detail, but it sounds like he wants to go do the same thing he's been doing at Project Veritas, doing these undercover exposés, which are always fun to watch. It's always good to see someone admitting the truth because they thought they were amongst friends. And the Pfizer thing was quite a revelation. So I hope to see James O'Keefe again in another situation. He talked about taking some of his employees with him. So it'll be interesting to see what happens with that. All right, we've got something else interesting coming down the pike here with the House Republicans. It's fun to see them doing things that we've all been wanting to see them do. And since they finally have the majority in the House, we get to see this. So House Republicans call on witness to testify to alleged Biden family bribery schemes. Yes, finally going to get into some of this. So tired of being called a conspiracy theorist for talking about how obviously corrupt Joe Biden is and Hunter Biden. It's nice to actually see this, some action being taken on this. I don't know if it's going to go anywhere, but it's nice to see some action finally being taken by the House on this. So House Oversight Committee Chairman James Comer, Republican out of Kentucky, on Tuesday called on a former Serbian politician to provide information to the lower chamber connected to the Biden family and their alleged involvement in international bribery schemes. The committee requests you schedule a transcribed interview with committee staff and produce certain documents related to the CEFC, Robert Hunter Biden, James Biden, and their business associates, the Kentucky Republican said. Comer wrote to Vuk Jeremic, seeking information related to prior testimony he gave during the 2018 trial of Patrick Ho, who was convicted in connection with an international bribery scheme. Comer noted Jeremy's testimony regarding his relationship with Ho and other officials of Chinese energy company CEFC. During the trial, you testified regarding your business relationship with certain CEFC officials, including Chairman Yi Jingming and Patrick Ho, both of whom had connections to the Chinese Communist Party, he wrote. After Patrick Ho was arrested, reports indicate that the Chinese government also detained Chairman Yi for violating Chinese bribery laws. I didn't know that they got detained in China for that. Anyway, this guy must be on the outs because he got in trouble. The committee is investigating whether President Biden knew of or was involved in certain foreign business ventures that included the same CEFC officials who participated in the schemes described in the U.S. versus Patrick Ho. Gotta love that name. Evidence shows that you developed a business relationship with Hunter Biden and his associates and communicated with them about Chairman Yi and CEFC, he continued. A press release from the committee indicated that the panel would further reach out to, quote, key witnesses to assist in investigating President Biden's role in his family's foreign business deals and to determine whether it has compromised national security, unquote. Comer gave Jeremic until March 14th to provide the committee with the requested documents and arrange an interview. So that's what we're waiting on. We're going to see whether this CERB will come along and testify about Hunter and Joe and James Biden and their dealings with this Chinese company. Ah, so much more to look forward to, which still makes me wonder, what is going on with the Twitter files on Fauci? I don't understand what the deal is. We were supposed to have Twitter files that Elon Musk promised us about Fauci. It's kind of sus that we don't have those. And that means suspicious for those of you that aren't regularly associating with middle schoolers and picking up their lingo like I have. All right, other exciting news. The J6 tapes are actually going to be released. Kevin McCarthy is giving them to Tucker Carlson. I think there was 47,000 hours of these things. And so Tucker Carlson's going to be going through all those with his staff. And we're actually going to see something other than what the Democrats decided to cherry pick and put together. So this is going to be very interesting. And how hopefully we'll get some of these questions answered, like, why didn't Nancy Pelosi secure the Capitol with a stronger police presence and an overwhelming National Guard presence as Trump authorized? And if the FBI knew in advance about the strong likelihood of a riot, why on earth didn't the Bureau stop it? And questions like, what exactly was the FBI's role in the J6 riot? And how many undercover agents were involved in ginning up the crowd and helping to orchestrate the violence? And questions like, who is Ray Epps? And why is the FBI being so tight-lipped about him more than 2 years after he was caught on videotape exhorting people to go in to the Capitol, and after his mug was quietly and mysteriously removed from the FBI's most wanted list? And questions like, who erected the infamous Capitol gallows, which, according to the mainstream media, was going to be used to hang Vice President Mike Pence? Those are all questions that I am sure that Tucker Carlson is going to be asking and answering. So keep watching, keep listening. I will be updating you as I get updates on that. But these are a lot of great questions. I mean, the FBI's fingerprints were all over that J6 riot. And it's incredibly suspicious that there were, even though all these emails were exchanged between Nancy Pelosi and the Capitol Police saying, hey, we hear there's going to be a riot, there was no increased security. That's just, yeah, it's like, I've said it before, I'll say it again, it's almost like the Democrats wanted there to be a riot. And it's almost as if the FBI was in there helping to make this thing be look bigger and worse than it did. Very, very interesting. So we're going to see all of the J6 footage. That's exciting. I can't wait for that. All right. So if you have missed any of my past episodes, naughty. But if you want to listen to them, you can go to my website at AnnetteTalks.com, or you can go to YouTube and type in Annette Talks or Annette on Life, Liberty, and Happiness, or you can go to Rumble, because YouTube likes to censor me and occasionally take down some of my episodes. So that's why I also put it on Rumble. And it's also on all the podcast platforms. So don't miss an episode. Go back and find it. Also, if you're a Facebook fanatic like I am, I mean, I'm on there way too much, go and find my radio group, the Annette on America radio group. I go on there every day and I ask a question, something that's currently going on. And I like to poll my audience because there's a lot of information, brains, good analysis. I've got some smart listeners. And so I like to hear what they have to say when I ask a question. It helps me to think things through. So go find me there. Lastly, if you are a business or you know of a business that has conservative values, but more importantly, you have a great service or a product and you want to advertise that on a conservative talk show on a great radio station, I'll bet I'm on AM 560 on Sunday nights at 9. I am on AM 1220 on Thursdays at 1. And as you just heard, I'm also on all the podcast platforms and YouTube. Anyway, I would love to chat with you about you becoming a sponsor, and so we can have a special relationship. The way you can do that is email me. Just email me at Annette@AnnetteTalks.com, or go to AnnetteTalks.com and fill out the little form there. And we'll talk, because that's what I do. I talk, right? All right. So don't miss the rest of the show. I have so many other things I want to talk about. We've got Fetterman. We've got Feinstein. We've got a revival in Kentucky. We've got Biden in the Ukraine. So many things. We've got Nikki Haley running for office. So do not leave. Come right back and finish this show with me. All right. Welcome back to Annette on America. Still Annette Bybee here. All right, so some interesting news. One of the things that I think is interesting is that recently Senator, who should not be Senator, John Fetterman, is recently been hospitalized for depression. And I just recently found out that it was not just depression, but severe depression, and that he's expected to be in the hospital for more than a month. There are so many problems with this. First of all, everyone knew from watching his debates and from seeing that he couldn't just have a normal conversation that this man was not fit for office. So we take this poor guy who's not fit for office and we stick him into the Senate, the U.S. Senate. This is not like giving him a job as a janitor at the school and saying, here, clean up the school. We put him in the U.S. Senate. You don't think he was in over his head big time? I could just see the poor man going to the office or sitting in the well of the Senate, not able to string some cohesive thoughts together and just feeling like, I don't know why I'm here. I'm confused. People want things from me. I have these people working for me that expect me to do things. They want me to vote. They want me to understand. I have to make these public appearances. I'm supposed to fundraise. I mean, I don't know if you've ever seen what a life is like in the life of a legislator, but it's difficult. This is really tough work. I mean, mentally, physically, emotionally exhausting work for a perfectly healthy, normal person. So you can't expect someone who's physically and mentally unhealthy to be able to go into the Senate and handle this. Of course, but so now he's not going to be conducting the business for his state for a month. And you know, that's just the beginning. He's already been hospitalized a couple of times. I wouldn't be surprised if he ends up resigning or passing away or something, and then they're probably going to appoint his wife. That's my guess of what's going to happen. But this is just sad. This should not be happening. I really do feel bad for the man. Yes, he shouldn't have run. But having the people around him pushing him into it, the Democrat Party pushing him into it, probably his wife, who knows who else, never should have happened. So there's not going to be a good end for Fetterman. And we're only in February. So this is, he's not going to get better. I think this is really sad. And they're saying that he may have had a second stroke. It's sad. So see what happens with that. All right, but also Feinstein recently says she's not going to run again. Not that she's resigning, but she's not going to run again. I just think that's funny. She's been unfit for a long time too. I mean, she doesn't even know what she's voting for. There are people have overheard her saying, "What did I just vote for?" she's 89. And she's got cognitive decline. Obviously, she's 89. There are very few people that live to be 89 who do not have some cognitive decline. So, it's good that she's not running again. But why doesn't she not resign? Again, it's like the Democrats don't care. You've got a body in there. If you can make that body vote the way you want that body to vote, it's all good. To heck with that person's quality of life, or whether they can serve their constituents, or whether they're in a reasonable situation for their life. No, it's all about getting that vote. Pretty sickening. And if it were Republicans doing this, I would be saying the same thing. Sickening. You don't do that. Just like, what's his name? The liar out there in New York. Kick him out. All right. Speaking of cognitive decline, Joe Biden had his yearly physical. And it's funny, they called him, what was the expression they used? Let me find that. Healthy, he's 80, he's healthy, and he's fit for duty. They must mean physically, right? This is the president remains fit for duty and fully executes all of his responsibilities without any exemptions or accommodations, the White House physician Kevin O'Connor said in a summary of the health exam. Really? What does that mean? He gets out of bed, puts on his clothes, sits in meetings, doesn't need a walker, doesn't need a wheelchair, doesn't need a cane, no accommodations? Yeah. So the exam was closely watched as Biden prepares for his expected run for a second term in 2024. I've been saying for a while, I don't see him running in 2024. But I didn't see him lasting this long into the presidency. So who knows at this point? If he does run, I mean, you could put up just about anyone against him in the primary. Well, we know who's going to run against him. We've got, what's his bucket? Well, Buttigieg, for one, because he's doing such a bang-up job in transportation, making sure that we all know there aren't enough Black people. Not enough Black men doing construction. Probably not enough transgenders doing construction either, I'm sure. Not enough gay men in construction. And then we've got Newsom, or Nuisance, as Californians like to call him. He's going to run. So there are plenty of Democrats that are willing to run against Biden. It's just, I think Biden wants to run. And I'm guessing Dr. Biden wants him to run. But will they really do that? Will they really make him suffer through that and us as a country? I mean, it'll be amusing, but really? Anyway, the summary said that Biden did not have any long COVID symptoms. Woo, that's good. And that his stiff gait has not worsened since his last exam. So he just has a stiff gait. Biden said his physical went well. Everything really went well. Thank God for small favors, he told NBC News. Biden's 3-hour session with doctors at Walter Reed National Military Medical Center in the Washington suburb of Bethesda, Maryland, was his second extensive exam since taking office in January 2021. Just talks about he takes a statin, he's got some skin growth, blah, blah, lost a little weight, has good blood pressure. This is the best part of this whole story. The summary made no mention of whether Biden underwent any cognitive tests sometimes given to people of his age. Biden, the oldest person ever to serve as U.S. president, has waved off questions about his age, but polls indicate voters have, this is funny, voters have concerns about his ability to serve four more years if he wins in 2024. Asked about the concerns over Biden's age, White House Press Secretary Karine Jean-Pierre told reporters, "This is a president that works day in and day out, you know, in a grueling fashion, with a grueling schedule, and delivers." Thank you, KJP. About three quarters of Americans, including more than half of Democrats and the vast majority of Republicans, say Biden is too old to work in government, according to a Reuters Ipsos poll conducted February 6th to 13th. Most Democratic respondents said the president remains, oh my gosh, this is too funny. Most Democratic respondents said the president remains mentally sharp. What does that say about the sharpness of those most Democratic respondents? But about half of them said he cannot handle the physical toll of the presidency. Yeah, it's just the physical toll, right? Biden does not drink alcohol or smoke tobacco and works out five times a week, the physical noted. Biden would be 86 by the end of a prospective second term, making him 13 years older than the average life expectancy of an American male. Biden said during a PBS interview last week that any Americans concerned about his age should watch me perform the duties of the presidency. First Lady Jill Biden, 71, last month had cancerous skin lesions removed. I don't know why that's important, but I didn't know she was 9 years younger. Maybe that's why she was making out with Kamala Harris's husband at the last State of the Union. I mean, just look at the pictures. That is not your typical kiss on the cheek kind of thing. So we have Fetterman is depressed. Feinstein is finally on her way out. Biden, why would the White House doctor even think about giving him a cognitive test? There's no reason to suspect that he has any problems just because he doesn't remember how his son died or any of the other little faux pas he's made over the year, like many, many, many. All right, so I think I mentioned on the last episode that Nikki Haley has thrown her hat into the ring to run against Trump. She's the only other Republican that has officially announced so far. And can I just say that I'm really not excited about already having the presidential election season going. This thing lasts for 2 years now. It's just too long. Anyway, but what's funny is this story about Nikki Haley and how she's accused of using her brown skin to launder white supremacy on MSNBC. See, if identity politics is everything to the left, unless you're on the right, then somehow it doesn't matter if you have what they would usually consider to be a useful identity, brown skin, or if you're gay or transgender or whatever. If you're on the right, that's going to be used against you. So presidential candidate Nikki Haley was accused of using her brown skin to launder white supremacist talking points during a racially charged interview on MSNBC Sunday night. I just wonder how many interviews that they have on MSNBC that are not racially charged. Anyway, I see Haley and I feel sad, Daily Beast contributor Wajahat Ali, told MSNBC host Mehdi Hassan, because she uses her brown skin as a weapon against poor black folks and poor brown black folks. She uses her brown skin to launder white supremacist talking points, Ali added. Haley wasn't the only member of the Indian American community that Ali blasted on MSNBC. Nikki Haley instead is the Dinesh D'Souza of Candace Owens. How does that make it? The Dinesh D'Souza of Candace Owens? Ali claimed in a jab at conservative filmmaker D'Souza, who is also Indian American, as well as talk show host Candace Owens. See, so if you're a conservative like Dinesh D'Souza and Indian, or if you're black like Candace Owens and you're conservative, then you are using your brown skin, but in the wrong way. If you're a liberal and you have brown skin, then you can go ahead and say white privilege. But if you have brown skin and you're conservative, you're somehow using it negatively. I can't wrap my head around that thinking. Ali also called Haley an alpha Karen with brown skin, a seeming reference to the former governor of South Carolina's age. A Karen is a popular insult on social media that is usually used to refer to middle-aged white women of privilege. See, I didn't know that Karens had to be white women of privilege. I thought it was just anyone that was rude and obnoxious. For white supremacists and racists, she's the perfect Manchurian candidate, Ali said. The liberal commentator also spoke at length on how white supremacists allegedly use Asian Americans to score political points. Instead of pulling us up from the bootstraps and pulling others up by their bootstraps, we're taught to take your boot and put it on the neck of poor browns, immigrants, refugees, and black folks, Ali argued, speaking on behalf of the entire Asian American community in the United States. But Ali claimed that the rest of America will never accept someone like Haley, whom he repeatedly called a woman with brown skin. So this is what happens when all you see is identity politics. All you see is skin color and racism. You are racist. You cannot see other people with brown skin and just see them as a person. You have to see their brown skin and you have to somehow say that they are using that brown skin in some way. Nikki, they'll never love you. It ain't worth it. It was a warning that he also leveled at members of the minority community who he also claimed will never be accepted in America. They'll never love you. They're not nuanced. Bigots don't care. If you put us all in a lineup, they're never going to be like, they're not going to be like, oh, you're the legal one. You're good. But Ali focused most of his ire on Haley, who made history as the first Indian American president of a member of a presidential cabinet in 2017 after she was sworn in as U.S. ambassador to the United Nations. Instead of applauding her, I am just disgusted by people like Nikki Haley, who know better, whose parents were the beneficiaries of the 1965 Immigration Nationality Act, which Ali claimed passed thanks to those original BLM protesters. Oh, no. You cannot compare the civil rights movement of the 60s to BLM now. Sorry. Today's BLM are a bunch of communists, Marxists. They admitted to that. And they're also are self-aggrandizing and self-enriching. They started this so they could rake in millions of dollars and buy themselves mansions and go on trips. That is not who MLK was. So Ali, liar. Ali repeatedly denied that Haley could be considered as just another member of the Indian American community. To quote Zora Neale Hurston, not all skin folk are kin folk, Ali said. This is how you get all twisted up in your thinking when all you do is see skin color. Guess what? When I think of Nikki Haley, I don't think about her skin color. I think about, is she conservative enough? Is she a strong enough conservative to take on Trump? Is she a good enough, does she have a good enough background? Does she have good enough debating skills? Can she hold her own? Can she compare? Does her background and her experience compare with Ron DeSantis? I don't care if she's a woman. I don't care what her color is. That's the difference between the left and the right. See, we are not all wrapped up in identity politics. We want people who can do the job and who will do the job in the best way. We don't want DEI. We're not looking for diversity, equity, or inclusion. We're looking for people who can do the job. And that's what people on the left don't get. They think that we all care the same way. We don't. And we're not bigots. We want people who can do the job. We don't care what color they are. All right. This is something. I've been noticing something interesting recently. And maybe just because this was close to home. At my daughter's charter school, one of the students died by suicide about a week and a half ago. And obviously it's hit very close to home. The student was in the same grade as one of my daughters, and everyone in that school was hit very hard by this. And I recently had a family member who died by suicide. I've been hearing about, from friends on social media, I'm just hearing about what feels like an uptick in suicide to me recently. And my thought is that we are in the last days, and that this is what we can expect more of in the last days. Satan is raging on the earth, and he's going after people in their weakest moment with their greatest weakness. And he's unfortunately catching some of them and in his trap, and they're taking their lives. And so it's very sad and it's very depressing. And it's really easy to start going down this road of, gosh, we live in terrible times. How will we ever survive it? But then I see a story like this, and I once again remember who's in charge, and that we know who's going to win in the end. Asbury University ends 24/7 revival meeting after 50,000 flock to Kentucky town over 13 days. The Asbury Revival has drawn tens of thousands of visitors from across country, overwhelming a small Kentucky college town. The marathon worship service at Asbury University that has drawn tens of thousands of participants from across the country is being forced to downsize. This is so awesome. School officials are saying that the rapid influx of visitors, whom they welcome and appreciate, is causing logistical issues for the surrounding area and will need to move off campus. We had authorities that had to redirect traffic away from Wilmore. Our town's institutions and our town's infrastructure is just not in a place to absorb the influx of the blessed guests that we have had, said Asbury University President Kevin Brown, according to Religion News Services. The evangelical service in Wilmore, Kentucky has been celebrating nonstop for 2 weeks in what many of its participants are calling a revival. The movement began after students refused to leave following a chapel service last Wednesday, and the services have since grown to pack the school's chapel with worshipers from all over the country. The university designated Monday as the concluding public worship service of the event, stating that from Tuesday onward, services would be moved off campus. Asbury will continue streaming parts of services still being held for young adults in Hughes Auditorium through Thursday. We are also tremendously thankful for the men and women who have worked so hard and diligently to create space for this special move of God. Hosting such a significant moment comes with a cost, and the goodwill and community of our community has been inspiring. Brown said in a statement. It concluded, finally, we cannot fully express the profound gratitude we have for stewarding this outpouring in the life of our school and beyond. Ultimately, we pray that our efforts in these days point to our Savior. So I just think that's awesome. I mean, this was just a out of the blue, impromptu revival from young people. And these are the ones that are leaving churches in droves. These are the 18, 19, 20, 21-year-olds, 22-year-olds who obviously are feeling a need. And I hope that we look at this and we say, kids, come to church. Come to church every week. I hope that those of you that have stopped going to church who are older than this, go back to church. Go, if you don't like your church anymore, go find a church. Crack open your Bible every day. Pray. Pray multiple times a day. I think we really are in the last days, and I think I'm afraid we are going to see more suicide as we live in times that are extremely difficult, mentally, physically, emotionally, just difficult. You just heard all the stuff I talked about over the last hour or so, and they're going to get worse before they get better. Those of us that know that the second coming is going to come after a lot of tribulation know this. We have got to be strong. The only place we're going to get the strength that we need is through our Savior. And these kids feel that need, obviously. They feel the need. I think we all need to look to that and say, let's get back into our churches. Let's get our kids back into church. If you've fallen away, go back. You cannot get the strength that you need to survive these last days and thrive. You can thrive in these times. If you have the Lord on your side, if you have the Spirit with you on a regular basis, you can thrive. So let's take that as a wake-up call. Get our kids into church. Invite our friends and neighbors back. Share the gospel. All right, I just thought that was so awesome. Maybe we are in another revival period. I really hope we are. All right, I don't have much time left. Let's see. I don't have time for that. We know that Biden went to Kyiv and is basically giving more money to Ukraine, and he's propping up their social security system. Basically, it's wrong. It's ridiculous. It's pathetic. We don't like that. When are we going to be done sending money to Ukraine? And why are we propping up their retirement? That is not part of defending them from Russia. It shouldn't be happening. It's wrong. Well, I do have one last story so we can end on a good note. And this is from my favorite news source, the Babylon Beat. This is about what I was just talking about. President Biden arrives in Kyiv. I guess it's really Kiev. I don't know why they keep changing the spellings in this, but anyway, for his performance review. Did you guys know that Biden gets performance reviews? They don't give them cognitive exams when he gets his annuals, his yearly annuals, but he does have these performance reviews. So, multiple insider sources reported a hushed nervousness was felt throughout President Joe Biden's entire entourage today as he arrived in Kyiv, Ukraine, for his annual performance review with Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky. "He's really hoping this meeting goes well," said one White House insider. "The president has been working really hard over the past year to do a good job for his superiors, and he's wanting it to pay off for him in this performance review. His commitment to working for Ukraine, sending all the weapons, military equipment, and taxpayer dollars really speaks for itself." Here I thought he got those performance reviews from China. President Biden seemed oblivious to the criticism his trip was receiving due to him flying to Kyiv rather than visiting the ecologically ravaged community of East Palestine, Ohio. Yeah, I'm sure that this story came out and then the EPA finally jumped on board. Anyway, "We understand there are people who are upset about the president not visiting East Palestine," said White House Press Secretary Karine Jean-Pierre. "But we saw pictures of that nasty black cloud of smoke. Are you kidding? The president can't breathe that stuff. He'd be safer in a war zone, quite frankly." If the performance review goes well, it's reported that President Biden is hoping it will result in a bump in his pay, with sources saying Biden wants a raise of at least 10% for the big guy. At publishing time, Biden was telling his advisors that once his meeting in Kyiv is finished, he wants Air Force One to fly to the Middle East, since he's been hearing something has been going on in East Palestine or something. I love the Babylon Bee. And my only addendum to that is, if he really wants to go for a performance review, he needs to head over to China and sit down with the CCP. And I'm guessing that he could get his 10% for the big guy over there too. By the way, if you don't know what that is, just Google 10% for the big guy and find out. And then you'll probably go down a whole rabbit hole where you find out about what's been going on with Biden and the stuff that's coming out with the House of Representatives and that we talked about earlier in this show. Again, if you missed any of this show, shame on you, but I'll let it fly. I'll let it pass just this once. If you will go to AnnetteTalks.com and listen to the rest of this episode. And while you're there, maybe you can click on my Patreon button and go become a patron. I could use the support. So anyway, all right. Well, thank you so much for listening today. Check again next week. I'm on every Thursday at 1 on 1220 AM, every Sunday night at 9 on 640 AM. Or you can, if you miss it, again, AnnetteTalks.com, YouTube, Rumble, podcast providers, etc., etc. So thanks for listening to Annette on America, where freedom lovers gather.
Thanks for listening to Annette on America. And join her again next week as she talks all things freedom, all things America.